Welcome to worship. My name is Heidi Henkel. I am the pastor here at Bethesda Presbyterian Church, and it is a joy to have you in worship with us today. Due to the snow and our weather, we are virtual only today, and we look forward to seeing those of you who come in person next week. We have postponed our congregational meeting to next Sunday. And so we will be doing worship at 10:30 next Sunday with our meeting to follow at 11:30 next Sunday. Also a reminder that next Sunday we will be celebrating the Sacrament of Communion. So you want to keep that in mind if you are virtually worshiping with us or if you will be with us in person. Let's center ourselves now as we use our call to worship to begin.
Join me in our call to worship. Come, hear the call of God. Speak of me to my people. But we are just ordinary folks. Who will listen? I will give you the words. I will always be with you as you speak my words of truth and justice and love. We gather here to worship you, to praise you, for your loving presence, and to be strengthened for the calling you have given us. Let's pray. God, as we worship this morning, virtually yet connected by your Spirit, be present with us. Speak your words to us, that we may go and proclaim your justice and your love to this world. May we tell the stories that we need to hear and that others also need to hear as well. Amen. I invite you to join in singing our opening worship song.
Blessed be your name, blessed be your name, in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow, blessed be your name, blessed be your name, when I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name. And every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. And when the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name.
On the road marked with suffering,
blessed be your name. On the road marked with suffering, though there's pain in the offering, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. And when the darkness closes in, Lord, still blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. And blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Oh, Father. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glory.
Take.
You give and take away,
give and take away. Lord, you give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. And blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. And blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. And blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Lord, blessed be your name.
Let us humbly approach God. For God's throne of grace is our place where we can confess our sins and present ourselves honestly before our Savior. Let's do that using our prayer of confession today. Savior God, you call us to love, but we relish the fight. We divide ourselves into us and them and refuse to cross over, compromise, or contemplate the ways of the other side. Humble us in our certainty and arrogance, God. Remind us of the power of love, calm conflict, and peace. Amen. Our God is a loving God, full of mercy. In Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Believe in this forgiveness. Be at peace and share the love you have graciously received. Amen. Our offering today, if you are worshiping with us, you have several options. You can give through our website by clicking on the Give button. You can mail your tithe into the church as always, or you can set up a bill pay through your bank. We continue to receive offerings, although not in our normal way at worship. We continue to receive them in these various ways, and you are invited to participate in the mission and the work of Bethesda through your giving.
Before His throne.
Testament reading today comes from the book of Jeremiah, chapter 1, verses 4 through 10. Hear the word of God from the book that we love. The word of the Lord came to me, saying, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I set you apart. I appointed you as a prophet to the nations." "Alas, sovereign Lord," I said, "I do not know how to speak. I am too young." But the Lord said to me, "Do not say I am too young. You must go to everyone I send you to and say whatever I command you. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you and will rescue you," declares the Lord. Then the Lord reached out his hand and touched my mouth and said to me, "I have put my words in your mouth. See, today I appoint you over nations and kingdoms to uproot and tear down, to destroy and overthrow, to build and to plant." Our New Testament scripture today comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 4, verses 21 through 30. Jesus began by saying to them, "Today this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his lips. "Isn't this Joseph's son?" they asked. Jesus said to them, "Surely you will quote this proverb to me, 'Physician, heal yourself,' and you will tell me, 'Do here in your hometown what we have heard that you did in Capernaum.'" "Truly, I tell you," he continued, "no prophet is accepted in his hometown. I assure you that there were many widows in Israel in Elijah's time, when the sky was shut for 3.5 years and there was a severe famine throughout the land. Yet Elijah was not sent to any of them, but to a widow in Zarephath in the region of Sidon. And there were many in Israel with leprosy in the time of Elisha the prophet, yet not one of them was cleansed, only Naaman the Syrian." All the people in the synagogue were furious when they heard this. They got up and drove him out of the town and took him to the brow of the hill on which the town was built, in order to throw him off the cliff. But he walked right through the crowd and went on his way. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Join me in prayer. God, as we come and approach this message today, as we hear the words that you speak to us, help us to also notice the anger and the fear or the places where we start to become uncomfortable when your word reaches our ears. Help us to hear this story and allow it to convict us in the places where we have been hiding. Bring to light the stories we have been telling ourselves to make ourselves comfortable. And may you continue to challenge us and grow us in our faith. Be present with us now so that the meditations of our hearts and our minds and our mouths would be pleasing to you, O God. Amen.
Jesus goes to his own hometown, and the people try to kill him, simply because Jesus tells the story that prophets tell, and prophets aren't accepted in their own hometown. This story is the second half to a piece that is just as stunning. This story actually begins when Jesus goes to the synagogue that day. He's an observant Jew, and he goes to the synagogue And that day he is chosen to be the reader of the scripture. And he comes forward and he reads a scripture from Isaiah. And he says, I am the one who has been anointed by the Spirit to come to the poor, to release the captives, to bring healing. And he sits down and he says, the scripture has been fulfilled. And he leaves off an entire piece of that scripture about vengeance. He says, today is the year and the day of the favor of our God. But he leaves off the second half that says, and the year of the vengeance of our God. Because Christ didn't come for vengeance. He came to save. And so when he sits down after saying this, and he tells the people it's been fulfilled, we can trust in the fact that all scripture is fulfilled in and by Jesus Christ. And if we don't see it in Jesus, we let it go. Because even the scriptures bow to Jesus. That was our big point before I've preached on this. I'll say it again, though. All scripture finds its fulfillment in and by Jesus Christ. All of it. So if we don't see it in Jesus, when we read the scriptures, if we don't see it in Jesus, you got to let it go. Because even the scriptures bow to God. The scriptures are the inspired thing that points us to God, but they are not God. And so as this story continues, Jesus has sat down. He's told the people that it's been fulfilled in their hearing. And we're told in the scripture that he was the hometown boy. And they were speaking well of him up to this point. They're actually kind of hoping that their boy would be the one, right? But Jesus anticipates the trouble that's coming. And he knows that no prophet is welcome in their own hometown. So Jesus tells two stories, and they're stories that are already in scripture. The people know these stories from before. So Jesus recounts two stories. And by the end, those who were his former neighbors were trying to kill him. And the Bible is a dangerous book. It's not tame. It's not safe. It's a dangerous book, especially if you emphasize the parts that people like to overlook. Now, the two stories that Jesus tells, they threaten the cohesion of the group. That's what we call social cohesion. It threatens that of the people of Nazareth. And so they, in turn, threaten Jesus' life. So let's take a look at these two stories and see why it unnerved people so much. The first one comes from 1 Kings 17. This takes place during the time of Elijah, and there is a massive drought happening. It's been 3.5 years since it's rained, and they are in massive drought, and as a result, famine. And so the people are hungry, they are dying of starvation, and Elijah decides to head north. He goes up to the place called Zarephath. And just so we're all clear, this is outside of Israel's territory. This is considered Gentile land. And he comes to the gates of the city, and there's a woman there who's gathering sticks. And Elijah asks the lady for a cup of water. And so she goes to get the cup of water, and then he also asks her to go and bake him a loaf of bread. And the lady responds. The woman turns and says, you know what? I'm going to take the sticks that I have gathered, and I am going to go take the only flour I have left, and I am going to go break a loaf of bread, and we're going to sit down with my son and eat it, and then I'm going to die of starvation with my son. And Elijah, in that moment, prophesies to her, as prophets do. And the woman says, to him when she's making this giant statement of, I'm going to go do this. She starts it out with, as long as Yahweh lives, I'm going to do this. So Elijah says, all right, you can go do that. Just bring me some of that bread. And so he does what a prophet does, and he says, this is what the Lord says for you, that your flour and your water will never run dry. And the miracle comes to pass. But this isn't just a story about God's provision for a widow. That's a nice, happy story, right? God provides for the widow. He makes water that never runs out and food that never stops in the middle of a drought and famine. Isn't that a happy story? But this is a story about God and God's love for Israel's enemies. The prophet went into enemy territory, and God does a miracle for an enemy widow. That's a subversive, dangerous story. And this story in 1 Kings doesn't make the point explicit. It just tells the story. But in Nazareth, Jesus makes sure to make the point very explicit. And so he gets to the point by saying, you know, in that time, there were plenty of widows in Israel, but God didn't do a miracle for them, did he? He chose to do it for your enemy. And as you can imagine, in that moment, the congregation is squirming. They're not okay with this. And it gets worse. Jesus tells a second story. This one is during the time of Elisha. That is Elijah's protege. And this is from 2 Kings 5. You can go ahead and read these stories for yourself. But it takes place during this time. And in these days, the greatest threat was the Syrian army to the north. And they were the dominant military power. And they had been doing raids on a regular basis into the northern camps of Israel. The Syrian general, the head of the Syrian army, his name was Naaman. And Naaman had a slave girl that served his wife. In fact, she was a Jewish slave girl. She was one who was captured on those northern raids. And when this slave girl hears that Naaman has leprosy, she makes an offhand remark. Gee, it's a shame you aren't in Israel because the prophet Elisha could heal you. And Naaman decides he's going to come south, and he meets Elisha. And Elisha tells him, if you want to be healed, you need to go dip yourself in the Jordan River 7 times. And Naaman is initially reluctant, but then goes and does it and is healed. Now, this isn't just a story, again, about a miracle healing of God can even heal leprosy. That would be a nice, safe story. But this is a story about, again, the miracle of healing an enemy of Israel. The general of the army that's been invading Israel's land, the one that they wish dead, the one who has taken their daughters and slaughtered their sons. Our God does a miracle for that person. So the book of Kings, these books, tell us an amazing story about a Sidonian widow and a Syrian general getting miracles and help from our God. What in the world is going on here? This turns things on their head. It's topsy-turvy, and it's nothing of what we like to hear. Things are not going the way they are supposed to go. They've been in the Bible for thousands of years, these stories. The people sitting there in the moment where Jesus is calling them out have heard these stories many times. And they probably heard them and said, oh, that's nice. And if you read them as just simple stories, they are innocuous. They are nice. But if you read them carefully, they begin to subvert this idea that God is partial, that God blesses us, but not them, that God does miracles for you and I, but not those people. It questions our assumption that God is partial to us. These are dangerous stories that upset social cohesion. I want to talk a little bit about this concept of social cohesion. What I mean by that is it is the way in which a group of people kind of coalesce together, bond together. And whether we like to admit it or not, a lot of our social cohesion happens because we have a common enemy, a common group or person to hate. Now, even as I say that, that makes you uncomfortable. Because even as the truth is, as the church, our common ground is supposed to be that we all love and share the same spirit. But there have been times, even now and even in our past, in which the church has made a common enemy and people have coalesced around that. It's dangerous. For those of us in Philadelphia, our sports fans, Philadelphia fans have social cohesion because they collectively hate the New York Giants or the Dallas Cowboys or the New England Patriots. There is a general love for Philadelphia, but we all agree we don't like those teams. But that's not what Jesus does. I mean, to put it into that example, it's like Jesus telling the story of God healing Daniel Jones or Eli Manning. God telling us the story of when our team is in the playoff of how he heals Dak Prescott or, God forbid, Tom Brady. And even as I say that, there's a whole part of you that's not happy with that story, right? God's supposed to be for our team, not for their team. How dare he heal their quarterback? How dare he deliver the win through that person? So we have this idea that God is partial to us and to our stories and to the stories we tell ourselves. These are the kind of stories that prophets tell. They're the ones we don't want to hear, but we need to hear. And Jesus is the pinnacle of the prophetic tradition for the Hebrew people. See, the Hebrew prophets started to do something different. Most prophets tell the story of how God is going to bless our people and curse our enemies. But the Hebrew prophets began to do something different, even in the Old Testament, like we've seen through Elijah, Elisha, and Isaiah. The Hebrew prophets began to engage in self-critique for their own nation and their own people. They engaged in this, especially in the times when the nation and the people failed. And so Jesus becomes the pinnacle of that and doing the same thing in this moment. And he comes out and he says right to the congregation's face, he doesn't want them to miss this point as he's preaching that day. He says, there were plenty of Jewish widows at that time, but God didn't heal them, did he? He healed a Gentile, your enemy. And there were plenty of military people at that time, but God chose to heal your enemy's general. And it makes them so enraged and angry. And it challenges all that's in them in that moment, so much so that they rush Jesus out to throw him off a cliff. The Bible is a dangerous book. especially when you emphasize the parts that people would rather overlook. And it's a big book. Things can hide in it. I mean, it can be 1,300, 1,500 pages, deciding on the size of your print. It's a big book with countless stories and stories in stories. It's easy to hide lots of points inside there. Jesus could have told a different story. There's plenty of them to choose from. He could have told him the mighty story about how Joshua comes into the land of Canaan and he walks around that wall obediently and the walls fall of Jericho and the Israelites move into the land of the Canaanites and they are the blessed people. The congregation would have loved to hear that story that day. Or he could have told the story of David and Goliath and how no matter what was up against them, the size of the army, God was going to deliver them because they were his righteous people and God blessed them. And he probably would have walked out of the synagogue that day to somebody in the back, his former neighbor, going, that was the best sermon ever. That was a great sermon, Rabbi. But just because it's a good story doesn't mean it's the story that you need to hear today. Prophets tell the type of stories that we don't want to hear, but we need to hear. And Jesus is trying to save the people of Nazareth, not entertain them. Nazareth needs to be saved from their religious zeal. They have a religious zeal for the vengeance on their enemies. They have this cohesion that they've built upon a common enemy, which is the Gentiles. They have coalesced around, and the people of Nazareth all agree on one thing. They all hate the Gentiles. But the problem is this cohesion that keeps the community together is built upon a sin. And that doesn't last forever. If you build something on the wrong foundation, it will come down. And there are plenty of Bible stories that Jesus could have given them to feed that vengeance zeal that they have. But he chooses not to talk about Joshua and Jericho, and he doesn't talk about David and Goliath. He tells them about Naaman and a widow of Zarephath. And that just about got him killed. I mean, this is early in Jesus' ministry. And what we notice in scripture is after this, Jesus begins to teach in parables. A lot of times we think that Jesus teaches in parables because it is a way for him to illustrate the picture and the idea even more. But Jesus uses parables to kind of hide the truth for us to figure out. It's interesting how the minute he stops teaching in parables, within a week he is crucified. So Jesus preaches this, and it gives us time to think about the parables. And just about the time he has moved on and out of the city, we get the point of the parables. And it's likely something we don't want to hear. But because Nazareth didn't like what Jesus had said to them, they lost Jesus and they lost their chance to be saved by Jesus. You know, as far as the text goes, he never returned back to Nazareth in his ministry, in his life. And I'm sure that they found some preacher in Nazareth to tell them the stories that they wanted to hear. This is really important. You can always find somebody to tell you the story that you want to hear. And sometimes there are going to be times when we do need to hear the story of David Goliath, when we're overwhelmed at the obstacle in front of us, and we need to hear that God is with us. And there are going to be times we need to hear the story of Joshua and Jericho. But that's not what these people needed right now. And so I wonder today, what are the Bible stories that we don't want to hear? I bet they're similar stories to the people of Nazareth. Because we tend to have a lot invested in this idea that God is on our side. We are invested that God takes sides. God is partial. I mean, we have this idea about it as human beings. We think that God is on our side. That God is on the side of our nation. That God's on the side of our denomination. Our political party. We're invested in this idea that God is deeply displeased with whatever you and I don't like. That God agrees with us. It's a very seductive thing. It's very seductive. And you can see it weaved in to almost every type of community out there. We like to hear the stories of Israel possessing the promised land because we cast ourselves in the position of Israel in the story. We think we are the good people, the good boys and girls, so we must be Israel in this story. And whoever Israel is fighting becomes the them. There's the us and then there's the them. And a lot of times we think that the Israel is us. But here's the biggest question I have for you, and this is going to really challenge you. What if we are not Israel? What if we're not the heroes of the story? What if we're not Moses, but we're actually the Pharaoh? What if we're not actually David, we are Goliath, the big bullies? What if we're not Joshua, we're actually the Canaanites? I mean, the good news is there's still hope even for us. When we read the story about Rahab, we know that she is the one who took in the foreigners at great cost to herself. And because she did, Israel was able to move into the land. So there is still hope for us. But we think so many times that we are the good boys and girls, that we are Israel, or our political party is good, or our nation is good. But what if we're telling ourselves the stories we want to hear rather than the stories we need to hear? I can already hear you coming across the cameras telling me, "Whoa, Pastor Heidi, back up there. You're making me super uncomfortable." You know, we tend to have a lot of this investment on the fact that God is on our side. And when we tell ourselves the stories that we want to hear that match the things that we hate and that we think are the problems, we become even more grounded in our own sin. But Jesus tells us today that it doesn't work that way, and the kingdom doesn't work that way. God tells us to love our enemies and to bless those who curse us. Do you notice that nowhere in there is there vengeance? Nowhere in there is a gun? Nowhere in there is Jesus telling us to go after and get those bad people and make them right? But the people in Nazareth said, no, we're going to hold on to that fantasy of David versus Goliath. And we're going to rise up and we're going to conquer the big bullies. And they tried to do that in the day. They tried to rise up against the Romans and they were slaughtered. I mean, just slaughtered. Many were imprisoned. That's not what Jesus was getting at. So I'm wondering today, what are the stories that you and I need to hear? What are the categories that we are creating the us and the thems? And perhaps even the harder question for you and I to answer is, what is the social cohesion holding our communities together? What groups of people or what people have we excluded as the thems and the bad people? That if Jesus walked into our church, we might have to hear a hard story from him challenging us. I'm wondering today if we're even able to hear those stories and receive them, if Jesus stood in our midst and told them to us. That uncomfortable feeling we have in here right now, that anxiety or the uncomfortableness as we listen to this story, that's the place where God's calling you and I to be challenged today, to receive God's Spirit and to allow God to teach us even more. As he continues to grow each and every one of us, may we continue to look like the image of God, to resemble him and to live out God's gracious mercy for every single person. For God created us all. We are all part of his family. Let's pray. Gracious God, I give you thanks that you continue to challenge us and grow us. You continue to teach us through Scripture, taking us deeper and helping us to understand your new ways of working. We thank you that you continue to take pieces of the Old Testament and show us what they look like in the light of your new kingdom ways. Help us to look to Christ, the author and the perfecter of our faith, so that everything in our lives bows to Christ, even if it's the story we've been telling ourselves and are having trouble of letting go of. Rewrite the story on our hearts today, O God. This we ask in your heavenly name. Amen.
Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save.
Life's first cry to Let us affirm our faith together using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let's lift our communities in prayer today, as well as those on our hearts and minds. Let's pray. Eternal God, you call us to a more radical love than words that are cross-stitched on a pillow or framed on a wall. You convey us to a love that includes our haters, our enemies, those who demean and humiliate us. God, how can we? How can we feel anything but disdain for awful people who treat us awfully? Grant us the courage and the strength, Holy God, to hold to that which is good. God, grant us patience in our practice of love. Help us not hit send on the scathing email that feels so justified. Help us pause to breathe in and exhale out. Help us to listen more and seek understanding and approach those with whom we disagree with curiosity, humility, and openness. Help us listen for the story beneath others' stories. Peace-loving God, help us not provoke others with hard certainties. Let us not be uncompromising and insistent on our own way. Open us to dialogue and to opinions different than our own. Build our endurance for bridge building across barriers of difference so we can wage peace in our segregated world. Finally, God, inspire us by your love through Christ's death and resurrection. Transform us in this love to live as Christ's disciples. Bless those in this pandemic times who are suffering, despairing, and grieving, and most in need of love. United as the body of Christ, we lift these prayers to you, O God. Praying the prayer you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, and thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I invite you to join in our closing worship song today.
Great is thy faithfulness, O Lord.
Bow to receive a blessing as we go from our devices. Love never ends. May you leave this worship service showered in the steadfast love of God, inspired by the love of the Holy Spirit, and ready to share the love of Jesus Christ with all who cross your path. May grace, hope, peace, and love of God the Creator, God the Sustainer, and God the Redeemer be with you all now and always. Amen. Thank you for joining us in worship today. I pray you all have a blessed and safe day.